So one of the things that becomes immediately clear when we go through a few quick examples of internal secondary data sources is that they tend to be cheap and they're easily accessible and offer highly detailed information about individual customers or segments of customers. That's definitely an advantage of why we like to use internal secondary data sources for marketing research. However, these do come with a number of limitations and often creates a situation where they only offer an incomplete picture of what we're trying to discover in terms of addressing a marketing research question. So first of all, the information that comes from internal secondary data sources tends to be very limited to the actual behaviors of a customer during actual purchases, or at least later in the purchase funnel. Transaction systems, of course, only capture actual customer behavior with respect to their actual purchase behaviors. So one of the problems here is a marketer usually wants to know actually what sort of behaviors customers or likely customers are going to do before and after purchase. And these types of routine data collection activities sometimes ignore or miss or don't offer a complete picture of these sort of activities. In addition, these sort of internal secondary data collection activities tend to focus on current customers and what they're actually doing. And of course, a marketer is often interested not just about current customers, but about potential customers or prospective customers or a given market segment. And these types of information gathering resources rarely capture this information in a systematic way. So that's a key limitation often of internal secondary data. There's also a scarcity of customer mindset information. If you go back and look at all the examples, it was very behavioral. So we know where people clicked, we know what they searched, we know when they actually purchased, but in none of the previous examples did we actually know what the customer's awareness level was for a variety of brands or products, what their interest, attitudes, or various psychographic or motivational states were towards a product, brand, service, or experience. These are things that marketers often want to know to tailor later marketing activities, and those are things that we rarely have direct insights about through internal secondary data collection activities. In addition, on one hand, in theory, this information should be easily accessible. In practice, oftentimes this type of internal secondary data is trapped in organizational silos, meaning that the social media team may have full control or access to the social media dashboards, but the brand manager may not have as quick and ready access to this information or information in the way that they want it. And finally, many organizations still struggle with these internal secondary data sources standing alone and not being integrated into a unified source of customer and prospective customer information. This limits the overarching insights that any given source could actually provide. With that said, there's a number of organizations that specialize in integrating data from disparate sources into a single source of truth that can be useful for marketing researchers. So according to IBM, we define data integration as the combination of technical and business processes used to combine data from disparate sources into meaningful and valuable information. The advantage here is you borrowing from like maybe an 80s business corporate boardroom word is synergy. By taking disparate data sources and integrating them into a unified whole, the individual pieces build together to create a more unified insight that we don't have by looking at each individual piece. Let me give you a simple example of what we mean by the value of data integration. And we'll use an example of a grocery store chain to illustrate this. So imagine a grocery store chain like Kroger. You can go to kroger.com and create a web account where you can log in, get access to your coupons, store shopping lists, and so on and so forth. And that's useful to Kroger. Now they know what you're saving, what you're interested in. And of course, Kroger, like any other grocery store chain, will track product purchases. So shopping cart analysis is a very old school and classic form of marketing analysis where we can find which sort of products are correlated and correspond to one another when they're with their purchase. And sometimes we use that information to pair those products together in the retail store space. We also use in-store promotions, sort of in-store couponing. You've probably gone to the grocery store and at the end, a series of free coupons were spit out at the end after you received your receipt. Hopefully those coupons will be, well, at least from the perspective of the grocery store, those coupons will be redeemed later. So now they have a way of tracking a given person, I'm sorry, a given shopping cart generating actually coming back at a later time and taking advantage of those coupons, so linking more than one shopping cart together. At-home promotions are also common for grocery stores, so inserts within newspapers or bulk mail being sent to addressable households. But all this information individually only provides a limited picture of what a particular individual is actually doing. Be much more useful to the marketer if we could sync web account behavior with shopping cart actual purchases, with their coupon redemption behavior, with their responses to in-home promotions. And the way to do that, of course, is through something like a loyalty card program. And with all of these, if a person has a loyalty card for Kroger, now the marketer can actually link individual purchases together into a longitudinal picture of what an individual is doing, how they're responding to coupons, in-store promotions, and web activities, offering a more comprehensive 360 view of what a person's actually doing. Even then, despite this being an advantageous form of data integration that allows the marketer to do things that it normally couldn't do by keeping these pieces of internal secondary data separate, we're still missing other pieces of relevant information. For example, the marketer might want to know, what's the household income of this particular individual? What is their psychographic profile? Are they a kayaker? Are they a tailgater? Are they somebody who has interests in political activities? How do those sort of interests and motivational states correspond to their actual behaviors? And now that type of information can't be easily generated internally by Kroger, but companies like Axiom specialize in aggregating emerging consumer data from a variety of external numerous sources. So now we're taking internal secondary data that's been integrated, those are the green arrows, and now we're also taking an external secondary data source, Axiom, and Axiom grabs information about individual consumers from numerous public and private sources. So census data, survey data, links it all together, repackages this data in a easy to link format to marketers' databases, and sells that information as a product. So this idea of data aggregators actually rebundling your information and selling that data as a product to other marketers is not a new idea, but it's definitely been gaining more traction and interest in today's world. One example here, actually I'm being maybe one of the more common examples, there was an interesting article by NPR where we found that when individuals were searching for health information on websites, a lot of this information that was being searched, particular keywords, were actually being tracked by these types of data brokers like the Axioms of the world. So in other words, if this company knows who you are through cookie tracking, and now they know what you're searching for, they have an ability to generate some estimate of your medical history or an idea of your medical history based on what you're searching. Now, if you'd like to know what kind of information is being tracked and what sort of insights are being estimated about you, in this particular case, Axiom provides a service called aboutthedata.com where you can log in and sign in and create access to your account and see the types of insights that Axiom actually believes to be true about you.